Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know you peer out from the top of the dais there. You look over this side of the dais, and you see nothing but no votes. And that might be true, but it didn't have to be that way. I'm not saying we would have agreed on everything, but there are some of us who know what it's like to argue with an uncaring insurance company to get a patient the most basic level of care. There are some of us who know what it's like to see an expectant mother in labor and delivery in the middle of the night with no real problem other than the fact that she's not been able to get prenatal care and needed reassurance that the baby was okay, and so she chose the most expensive way to do it. There are those of us, you strip away the politics, who believe we need to do something to address access to our healthcare system. We absolutely do have serious issues, and I agree. They require our attention. Now, maybe you could have had my vote, maybe not, I don't know. What I do know is you never tried. And that's a shame. It's a shame to those who might have concerns about some policies, but also realize improvements need to be made. When we talk about access to care, I think most Democrats on the committee genuinely care about the issue as I do. It is unfortunate. I believe this bill will actually hurt access to care. Will it help some? Maybe. Will it hurt some? Probably. And what about the cost? Cost is a problem because we just don't know. Yesterday, we had a meeting with the Congressional Budget Office. The doors were closed. Press was excluded from the room. All the bright lights were turned off. And we heard about the numbers that are often quoted in the press. But now we know those numbers are a sham. They were based only on a part of the bill and really only on a staff description, not on legislative text. Now, I had a professor at Parkland Hospital who used to tell us when we were presenting cases, and they might have an air of disbelief about them, the chairman would say, if you're going to tell a story, at least start it out with once upon a time so I'll know what you're doing. We should have done that yesterday with the Congressional Budget Office. And even still, the score tops $1 trillion, probably two, probably higher, and still leaves 17 million people uninsured. We haven't even talked about the people who are in this country without the benefit of a Social Security number. The spending really doesn't start until year 5 and spirals upward. What will it be in year 11, year 20? I think we're in for a real shock when we get a real score on a real bill. And this is important. Think of the men and women who were here in 1965 who designed Medicare. What if they had taken the time and trouble to look ahead to the year 2009, to the year 2017? Well, here's what we do know. This bill does nothing to deal with defensive medicine. As a result of the liability system that's driven by unnecessary lawsuits, it does not seize the monumental opportunity to reform Medicaid for our neediest citizens. It seems to tip the hat to some fundamental problems, and that adds 15 million new Americans to the roll, essentially making the problem from bad to unmanageable. Medicare payment is still allowed to fluctuate, leaving our nation's seniors unsure whether their doctor will be able to see them next year, and unfortunately, despite some provisions, the bill does not make the generational investment into the physician workforce that will be needed to ensure that everyone who has provided coverage on the bill can actually see a doctor. Can I tell my constituents their costs will go down or they'll get to keep what they like? I can't. I wish I could. Mr. Chairman, I didn't start out as a no on this bill. I was not a default no when we started this process. But where we've gone and where we've ended up, I have no other choice. I'll yield back the balance of my time.